This is a 2009 Honda S2000, a beautifully balanced, wonderfully simple darling that drivers love. But despite all of that, there are people on the internet who will tell you to stay away from it because of snap oversteer. What is snap oversteer exactly? Well, we'll get into that. But I think the simplest way to put it is that it's a boogeyman that keeps drivers afraid of cars like this. Just like the boogeyman, it's not real. That's why Honda lent us this bone stock 18,000 mile S2000 CR from their heritage collection so that I can show you.
What you gonna show him, Kyle?
Wait, hold up, I thought I was driving.
No.
No, hold on. I can do this.
Oh yeah? How many takes is it gonna take you?
Three or four.
I can do it in one.
But I really wanna drive it.
What was that?
I said I wanna drive it!
What?
I want to drive it! I thought I was the editor-in-chief. That's Nik Romano, pro driver, coach, car control expert, and I guess he's on his way to the skid pad right now to show us what's up.
I've been teaching car control for over a decade. I can thank the S2000 for a decent chunk of my business. Far too often, I've had people want to take a car control course only after having a scary moment in an S2000. They're all too ready to blame the Honda's short wheelbase or front mid engine for causing it to snap unexpectedly until I can show them that that's not really what's happening.
Now we're headed out onto the skid pad to do this for real. We've got this really nice, long, high-speed sweeping right-hander, and I'm gonna go into that corner and just do all the wrong things. Now this car is known for being kind of an oversteering mess, right? That's its reputation. But if that was true, then I shouldn't be able to do this. Huh. That feels a lot like understeer, doesn't it? Then if I lift off the gas, whoa! We go entirely in the other direction into oversteer.
So what exactly happened there? Well, I'm taking the turn right at the limit of grip, the limit of what the tires can handle. From there, I added a ton of steering to the right without taking my foot off the gas, and we lost traction in the front. Too much speed for too much steering input. That's how you can get understeer on any car, even an S2000. But going around that same corner at the same grip threshold, I was able to get the car to oversteer just by lifting off the throttle. The weight shifts off the back wheels, giving them less grip, and the rear swings out to turn the car around. This is liftoff oversteer, and the reason I wouldn't call it snap oversteer is because my inputs told the car to do that.
Now this time around, I'm gonna go into it the same exact corner at the same exact speed, but I'm gonna change my inputs to the car and let's see what happens. So I'm in the middle of the turn, now I give it a nice, slow, smooth release, and look at that! The car's nice and tame, nice and happy, and I'm still pointing the same direction I wanted to go.
Now that I'm letting off the throttle less violently, the car is responding less violently. Even though I'm still right at the limit of grip, the change to that grip is less dramatic and much more manageable.
Now sometimes, even with the best intentions and the smoothest of inputs, oversteer is inevitable. So what do you do then? Well, let's see. I'm gonna adjust what I do with my hands this time rather than my feet. Just a couple of really small, really quick countersteers in the direction of the slide, and once again, the car's still pointed forward, and we're still going the direction we wanted to go.
In this example, the rear wants to step out just like it did when I spun, but because I countersteer in response to my own throttle input, rather than reacting to the slide after it starts, the car stays online, and the rear slows down as it slides to eventually regain grip. Whether I'm subtly changing the balance of the car with smooth throttle input, or more aggressively correcting the balance of the car with a countersteer, the result is the same. I'm still pointing the direction I want to go, and I'm still online without having crab walked my way across the course.
Now, when people are referring to snap oversteer, it's not just liftoff oversteer that they're talking about. It could be weight transfer, like this. Lift off one direction, and then it snaps the other way. Now, you'll notice, we didn't spin out, so it is still possible to catch.
Now this is what happens when people know just enough to be dangerous. They've got the idea of countersteering down, but they don't realize that when the tires successfully re-grip, they need to recover the steering back to pointing into the corner. Otherwise, you're turning right into a left-hander. And as the weight transfers, you're just gonna lose grip again, but in the other direction. So what do I mean when I say weight transfer? Well, Kyle's got a way to show you exactly what we're talking about.
Okay, so I stole my 10-year-old neighbor's RC car to show you what I'm talking about. As a car accelerates, the force moving it forward is the grip at the point where the tire is contacting the road, but the center of mass is higher than that. So when a car accelerates, the weight wants to shift backwards, pushing the rear tires into the ground. When a car brakes, it does the opposite. The weight shifts forward, pushing the nose into the ground and loading up the front tires. When you go into a corner, the same thing happens from side to side. Pretty much every input you make has an effect on where the balance of the car sits. What people call snap oversteer is actually just oversteer that they're not expecting. So how do you know? Well, as the car leans to one side in the corner and the driver either lifts off the throttle or even brakes, the weight transfers off the rear tires, giving them less grip. People call it snap oversteer because they don't realize it's coming and they're not ready to do anything about it, or they don't even know what to do. But it doesn't happen without warning. It happens with reason. The driver's input is what causes the oversteer. You don't need fast reactions to catch a snap if you're paying attention to what you're telling the car to do. Wait a second. If that's here, what's Nik driving?
This beat goes stupid.
This SW20 MR2 is another car that gets accused of snap oversteer because of its turbocharged mid-mounted engine. And this particular one is even spicier thanks to its Garrett GTX 3076 turbo pushing 19 pounds of boost into its little four banger and over 430 horsepower out to those rear wheels. And that's just the conservative tune.
The turbo is not going to affect the way this car behaves with liftoff oversteer, but having a couple hundred pounds of engine behind me absolutely will. So let's apply the same techniques I used in the S2000 and see if that's going to help me manage the balance of the MR2. Into the corner, at the limit, and then a big lift, and there's the oversteer. But the same exact techniques, that little bit of countersteer and correction brought the car right back in line.
With more weight on the rear axle, the MR2 has more inertia in the rear. What that means is, when you do get oversteer, you need to countersteer sooner and for longer before the tires re-grip. Inertia is basically a thing's resistance to change. And when you've told the rear of the car to do one thing, it takes that much longer to tell it that you've changed your mind. Again, you're telling the car what to do. The car is not deciding to snap, it's listening to your inputs and obeying.
Now I can already hear you saying, the MR2 is a widowmaker because of the turbo lag. Well, if that's true, then if any car was gonna snap, it'd be this one right now. Here we go. Full throttle and boost!
Now I'm not telling the turbo when to give me that extra power. It's a delayed response to the big dumb input of me putting my foot to the floor, but it's still a predictable response. And just like liftoff oversteer being cause and effect, you only need to go full throttle a few times in this car before you can get the timing to anticipate the turbo lag.
So it's not about the car, it's about the inputs. The car is only ever going to do what you tell it to do. And as long as you know what you're telling it to do, you can always recover from it.
Both the MR2 and the S2000 have characteristics that make it more important to understand what you're asking the car to do. Cars that are generally considered easy to control usually have a front-heavy weight balance. The balance of the S2000 is much more centralized, and the MR2 is straight-up rear-heavy. More inertia in the rear means more effort is needed to get the back end to re-grip. Both of these cars also have a relatively short wheelbase, which makes them respond to input more quickly. But even the most manageable car in the world can still go into a slide. And even this tail-happy twosome can be tamed.
Well, better you than me showing how it's done, I guess. But I gotta ask, why do you think the myth of the snap has endured? It's not like you're the first professional driver to point out that cars just do what you tell them to do.
Well, there's a lot of bad drivers out there, and a lot of them can't really take accountability for their own mistake, so it must be the car's fault.
Amen.
No, but really, in truth, these are two very special cars. They're different from your average commuter car. They're different than your average sports car, even. And that difference is, more so than almost any other car, these will really do exactly what you tell them to do. If you tell it to transfer weight to the front, it's gonna transfer weight to the front. And that means the weight's coming off the rear, and that means it's gonna rotate. Now, a pro driver wants that to happen. A new driver who's not expecting it, well, they're not expecting it, and they might end up in a spin or a crash or who knows what.
Fair points, but Honda did re-engineer the S2000's rear suspension in its second generation, so I assume there's a line between responsive enough and too responsive, right?
Well, You're using the word responsive, but in my world, we would just call it, does the car understeer, does the car oversteer? What is the vehicle dynamics? What's its balance? And yeah, the old S2000, the AP1, had more of an oversteer balance, and the new one, the AP2, has more of an understeer balance. And that's neither better nor worse, but Honda, like all other auto manufacturers, is in the business of making money, not losing money. And if the people are telling them they want a car with more stability, less oversteer, well, then they're happy to make that car.
So there you have it. There is no snap, just a response, because the car is only doing what you tell it to. Huge thanks to Honda for lending us this S2000 for this video. Thanks to Bob Pham for the MR2 back there. And thank you for watching. Did we bust this myth? Leave you more confused than ever? Let us know in the comments. I'll see you next time.
I'm disproving our own theory.